co-teaches.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me than all in all. Jesus paid it all. To him I owe sin. I left a crimson stain. He washed you white as snow. Now indeed I find thy power in thine alone can change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all to him my own sin. The crimson stain, he was you white as snow. In the morning when I rise, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, give me this world, give me Jesus. And when I come to die, oh, when I come to die, to die, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, you can have this world, give me Jesus. stand in him complete. Jesus died my soul to save. My lips shall still repeat, Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He was too white as snow.
Caden Ritchie, who is Jesus to you?
He is my Lord.
Caden, on your profession of faith in Jesus, it's with great joy I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism, rise to walk in newness of life. Hannah Ritchie, who is Jesus to you?
He is my Lord.
Hannah, on your profession of faith in Jesus, it's with great joy I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism, rise to walk in newness of life. Jesus to you.
He is my Lord.
Ray, on your profession of faith in Jesus, it's with great joy I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism, rise to walk in newness of life. Lord, we've done as you've commanded us, and still there is room.
What a pleasure it is to be in God's house today. Would you stand and welcome those around you to worship? We're glad you're here.
Mercy.
Amen. Please be seated. Thank you.
This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you for coming to the house of God today. It's a beautiful day outside, and we're going to have a wonderful time inside as we lift our hearts and our voices together in worship. And you're not here by accident. God brought you here because just maybe He has something special to say to you in these moments we spend together. If you're our guest, just relax and take it all in. We'll not embarrass you in any way. You don't need to know any secret codes or anything. Just relax and enjoy it. Follow along. We'll follow the service as it's written in the order of worship. Later on, when I give my talk from the book of Jonah, there's a listening guide you can use to follow. Keep you awake, keep you on track with what I have to say. If you are our guest, please help us by filling out a communication card. Let us know a little bit about yourself, and then put it in the offering plate at the end of the hour. Would you bow with me, please? Our Father and our God, thank you so much for this day. Thank you that we are here to see it, and that you woke us up so that we could be in church today. I pray, Lord, you're going to speak to us in a mighty way in this next several moments. We pray you'll be honored and glorified by what we've prepared to offer to you. And Lord, we're listening for your voice that our lives might be different. Be with all those who are sick and those who grieve today, people who are far, far away, either geographically or spiritually. We pray you'll bring them home soon. And Lord, we give this time now for you to accomplish great things in our midst through Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
God's grace, it's greater than all of our sin. Would you stand? Let's continue to worship together.
Glory be souls, right?
Please be seated.
Take your copy of God's Word, please, and turn to the book of Jonah, deep in the Old Testament, Jonah chapter 3. We've got one more message in this series that I've entitled, Things That Are Hard to Swallow. And I guess that title came from the great fish swallowing Jonah. Things that are hard to swallow. The first week, we talked about the fact that God has a call for your life. Sometimes that's hard for you to grasp, that He has something for you to do. Secondly, the second thing hard to swallow is God's amazing grace. No matter what we've done, He still loves us and is willing to pardon us. Today, the thing that is hard to swallow is probably the hardest of all, and that is that God still judges sin. We don't want to hear it. You hardly ever hear it, but I want you to hear it today, and maybe that's why you have come. We're in chapter 3, and chapter 3 begins just like chapter 1 began. In chapter 1, God calls Jonah, but he won't go. In chapter 3, after the experience in the great fish, and you know, that'll sharpen your mind. That'll focus your mind when you're in the belly of a whale for 3 days and then vomited up on shore. You'll think differently about a few things. And as chapter 3 begins, in almost the same terminology, it's a little different this time. Read chapter 1, verse 1. The word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai, go to that great city of Nineveh and preach against it, because its wickedness has come up before me. But Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed for Tarshish. Now go to chapter 3. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. Go to the great city of Nineveh and proclaim to it the message that I give you. Jonah obeyed the word of the Lord this time, and he went to Nineveh. Now Nineveh was a very important city. A visit required 3 days. Well, the Pope's coming to town this week for 3 days. It takes that amount of time to do what he wants to do in Washington. On the first day, Jonah started into the city. He proclaimed, 40 more days and Nineveh will be overturned. Period. That was his sermon. 40 more days and Nineveh will be overturned. The Ninevites believed God. They declared a fast, and all of them, from the greatest to the least, put on sackcloth. When the news reached the king of Nineveh, he rose up from his throne, took off his royal robes, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat down in the dust. Then he issued a proclamation in Nineveh. By the decree of the king and his nobles, do not let any man or beast, herd or flock, taste anything. Do not let them eat or drink, but let man and beast be covered with sackcloth. Let everyone call urgently on God. Let them give up their evil ways and their violence. Who knows, God may yet relent and with compassion turn from his fierce anger so that we will not perish. When God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, he had compassion and did not bring upon them the destruction he had threatened. This is the greatest miracle in the book. You thought it was the fish thing. That's only 3 verses out of the whole book. This is the great miracle that happened in the city of Nineveh. This is God's word for us today. Thanks be to God. Do you enjoy city life? Do you like living where you live? I love big cities. I love ours. I love the cities of America. I love the great cities of the world, and I've tried to get to a lot of them. I enjoy walking their streets, and I especially enjoy riding their metro systems. And I used to think we had the best, but I've seen some better ones. Probably the best one is in Moscow. Great subway system. When we were in São Paulo, Brazil last year for my son's wedding, they have a great system. And he took me down into the station, down in the tunnel, and I was a little bit intimidated by all the millions of people rushing by and getting on the train and everything. And he said, Dad, don't worry. In Brazil, it is the law that everybody has to give up their seat for the elderly. And sure enough, a pregnant woman and 3 kids got up so I could sit down. But that's a great system. I love cities. And you know what? God loves cities too. He loves big cities. Willie Sutton was the great bank robber of another generation. They asked him once, or reportedly asked him, "Why do you rob banks?" He said, "Because that's where the money is." He loved to rob banks. That was his calling in life. It's good to have a passion, you know, for something. And that was his. But he said, that's where the money is. God loves big cities because that's where the people are. Yeah. God so loved the world, he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish. God loves everybody individually. He loves you, but he loves those big cities where millions of people congregate. Cities originally were meant to be places of refuge. If you were accused of a crime you didn't commit and there was some vigilante group after you, if you could get to the city, you could be safe. They couldn't harm you there until you had a proper trial, a place of refuge. But because of sin, cities ended up being places of great violence and racism and other problems. God intended cities to be places of justice where you could get a fair trial, but because of sin, cities have become places where people run away from the justice of God. God has his standards, God has his morality, but in the city you can run and hide from it. You can't live with your boyfriend back at home, but you can do it when you get to the big city, because who knows and who cares? You can live your own life. And God intended cities to be places of great culture. And I love our city for that very reason. You know, we've got the Kennedy Center. But I got to tell you, the Kennedy Center doesn't have anything on First Baptist Church of Alexandria. Thursday night, we had the Kiev Symphony Orchestra and chorus in this place. And I hate to tell you about it now because it's over. You can't come. But it was magnificent. The city was meant to be a place of culture. But because of sin, our artists more usually glorify man and ignore God. God loves cities, though. He loves cities because that's where the people are. And he loves Nineveh. Nineveh is not called a wicked city in Jonah. It's called a great city that had wickedness in it. And ours is a great city, but it's got wickedness in it. That wickedness in Jonah's day had come up before the nostrils of God. He had seen it, and he hated it, and something had to be done. And so he sent Jonah, tried to send him in chapter 1, but he does send him in chapter 3. And Jonah goes to preach, destruction is coming. Judgment is coming. Now here's my point. Today, though that was a long time ago, and we're sophisticates today, we're in the 21st century of all times and places, God has not changed, and God still hates sin. Malachi chapter 3, I am the Lord, I change not. In the New Testament, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. God's standards are still in force. Now, God loves us, but he hates our sin. God has a great, great love for us. But he's a holy God. Now, I know you may have grown up where you heard that all the time, and it was drummed into you, and you began to resent that. All you ever heard was the fierce judgment of God and the wrath of God, and it turned you off. That doesn't mean the message was wrong. It means it was delivered out of balance. You've always got to balance the holiness and the judgment of God with the love and the grace of God. And that's what we try to do at our church. But you've got to understand that God still judges sin. That's number one on your listening guide. In Numbers chapter 14, verse 18, the scripture says God is a God of love and mercy and grace. But the verse goes on to say, yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. In other words, he is a gracious God who loves you, but he's not going to leave you unpunished. If you go on, persist on in your sin. Romans chapter 1, verse 18. The wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all unrighteousness that men do. The wrath of God is being, not will be, that's coming in the future, yes. There is a great day of judgment, but this wrath of God is coming now because of the rebellion of God's people. It's real. God judges individuals. God judges cities and nations. He judged Jerusalem in the Old Testament. He judged Jerusalem with its fall in A.D. 70. He judged Sodom and Gomorrah in the book of Genesis. And I am not prepared to tell you today that God will not judge us. There's no reason to think that He will not. God will judge sin. He judges individuals. He judges cities and countries. He even judges churches. 1 Peter chapter 4 says, judgment will begin with the family of God. And if it starts with us, what will be the end of those who do not know the gospel of truth? Starts with us. Read Revelation sometime. I know the bulk of it is sometimes difficult to wade through, but read chapters 2 and 3. You can't mistake it. Chapters 2 and 3 of Revelation, Jesus is talking to specific churches, just like ours, and He's saying, what you're doing is not pleasing to Me, and I will judge you. And He gives specific examples of the judgment that will come. God still judges sin. Now, when we talk about the wrath of God, Romans 1, 18, the wrath of God is being revealed. Don't misunderstand that. I mean, you get angry, and you get mad, and you fly off the handle, and you say things you shouldn't say, and you throw things, and you slam doors. I guess everybody does that sometime or other, and we think that's how God is, but that's not God's wrath. God doesn't throw temper tantrums. He doesn't lose control. This is not theatrical. God's wrath is His settled disposition against sin. Sin is affront to His character and nature. It cannot abide in His presence. He doesn't go off the handle. He doesn't lose control, but He judges sin. But now, we've got a perfect example in the situation with Nineveh. The second thing on your listening guide, God always gives a warning first. He always gives a warning first. That's what He's doing with Nineveh. He warns them, this is coming. He will use a prophet like Jonah. He will use a preacher. But certainly, ever and always, He uses His Word. Read the Bible and you will see that this is what God says. And as you read the Bible, it's not all little pleasant platitudes. There's some harsh passages in here where God says that sin is an abomination before Him. And we don't think like that. We don't talk like that anymore. But God's Word has not changed. He'll use Scripture. Back in July 1741, there was a preacher up in Northampton, Massachusetts, who rose in his pulpit on a particular Sunday that summer month, and he preached the most famous sermon ever preached in American history anyway. And you've heard of it. You may have studied it in English class. Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. In that sermon, Jonathan Edwards described the judgment of God. He painted a vivid picture of a literal hell, and he described his listeners as those who were hanging by a slender thread over the flames of hell and were only held there by the pleasure of God, and at any moment that cord could break and they would fall into hell. You've never heard a sermon like that. You've never heard me say anything like that. But he was preaching from the Bible, and he was talking about the reality of judgment. And as he preached, historians say that people began to moan and to shriek and to cry out. This is in staid New England. Cry out, what must we do to be saved? Now, Jonathan Edwards was not a very imposing figure physically. He did not have a strong voice. And he wrote his sermons, and then he read them. And they were long in those days. How would you like to sit and listen to somebody read a long, tedious sermon? And he didn't have good eyesight, and he didn't read very well, and so he had to hold it right up to his face, covering his voice. But even then, as boring as that sounds, God used it to shape a nation. God always warns of judgment that is coming, and so He does it here. Jonah gets a second chance to obey God. In chapter 1, he disobeyed. He ran. He got on a ship for Tarshish, the western coast of Spain. He ran, but now God's given him a second chance. God doesn't always do that. If God has called you to do something, He may only call you once. When God calls you to do something, say yes and do it immediately. Notice His message. 40 days and Nineveh will be overturned. In the original language, Hebrew, that's 5 words. Could the sermon have been longer? Maybe, but these are the only 5 we're given, so I'm going to say this was his sermon. 40 days and Nineveh will be overturned. It's brief, and it is remarkably graceless. Sermons don't have to be long to be powerful, do they? I probably shouldn't admit this to you, but you know, the sermon doesn't have to be an hour. It doesn't have to be 30 minutes. It could be very, very brief. This is a very brief sermon. I don't know if it was something about the way Jonah looked. You know, he'd just come out of the belly of the whale. Maybe he hadn't even had time to freshen up. And his skin color had been disfigured because of the stomach acids of the fish, and his hair was disheveled and all, and he probably didn't smell very good either. So it could have been part of his physical nature. Might have been his voice. Unlike Jonathan Edwards, maybe he had a powerful voice. But with those 5 brief words, he preaches. Now, I said it's graceless. Notice he says judgment is coming in 40 days, and he doesn't tell them what to do about it. He doesn't tell them to repent. At least it's not recorded here. He doesn't tell them what to do. He just announces judgment. I don't know if God wanted him to say more or not, but you know, Jonah's there reluctantly. He did not want to do it. We learned that in chapter 1. He still doesn't want to be there, but he knows he better do what God says. So he gives the bare bones message. Look at verse 9. When revival begins and people begin turning to God, verse 9, the king says, do all of this, do this repentance in sackcloth and ashes. Who knows? God may yet relent and with compassion turn from his fierce anger so that we will not perish. Who knows? Well, Jonah knew, but he ain't saying. Jonah knew that if they would repent, God would relent and would spare them, but he won't even tell them that word of grace. I'm always going to give you the word of grace. If I'm going to be faithful to God's word, I got to tell you that sin has a price. But I'm always going to tell you that if you'll turn from your sin, that gracious, loving God will forgive you. He preaches this powerful, powerful sermon, and the Ninevites are given 40 days. 40 days, and the city will be overturned. 40 days. That's a pretty long time, isn't it? That's more than a month. 40 days. You got 40 days. You don't know if you've got 40 days, do you? You may just have this afternoon. You may just have another week, and your life will be over. None of us knows. But if you did know, you had 40 days to get your house in order, to get right with God. What would you do with it? How would you spend those days? Now, don't go see the Grand Canyon. You know, it'll always be there, and you'll have a chance to see that when eternity begins, the great places in the earth. Don't go skydiving. Why press your luck? You got 40 days. Do something serious. Do something consequential. Go see people that you've offended, people that you have wronged. Pay your debts. Talk to God about your sin. Get right with Him. 40 days and the city will be overturned. Well, here's the miracle, the amazing story that's in chapter 3. The people of Nineveh repent and the city is spared. The people repent. I mean, they really do. They are overwhelmed with conviction. They cry out to God. They turn from their wicked ways. They dress in sackcloth and ashes. That's a symbol. That's an outer expression. That's what Ash Wednesday is all about, a sign of repentance and humility before God. And notice, it's not just the people. The king orders even the animals to fast. Isn't that odd? Even the animals are to be dressed in sackcloth. This is an amazing miracle. Now, here's the good news, folks. If you will turn from your sin, if our nation will, if our church will, if our families will, if we will turn from our sin, He is gracious and loving and willing to forgive us. But we've got to repent. We can't just go on and think it'll never catch up with us. It will catch up with us. Be sure, the Bible says, your sin will find you out. These people were ready for a change. They were ready for a change. Maybe that explains some of it. Nineveh in the 8th century B.C. was in crisis. Famine was in the land. There was constant turmoil and enemy attacks after them all the time. They were a city that was under great pressure. And when that happens to a family or a community or a nation, when everything's up in turmoil, people tend to turn to God. You remember 9/11. I wasn't here, but I bet you this church was packed the Sunday after 9/11. And kids were sitting with their parents and grandparents. It happened at my church in Danville. I know that it happened there. Kids came home from college to be with their families, to be in church. When a nation is in turmoil, people reach out for God. So maybe that's happening. Now, I want to show you something that I learned this week that might change this whole thing. Look again at his message, verse 4. On the first day Jonah started into the city, he proclaimed, 40 more days and Nineveh will be overturned. I don't know exactly what Jonah meant, but I know what the people heard. The word overturned there means turned upside down. It means to be radically changed. Jonah probably meant you're going to be destroyed, but the people, grasping for hope, heard in 40 days, our whole lives can be turned upside down. They chose to embrace the message of hope, and I do too. I believe it's possible that no matter the mess you are in, there's a word of hope for you, that if you will turn to God through Jesus Christ, you can have new life. And sure enough, it happened. Revival began. It was a great revival. Some call it the greatest revival in human history. Did it last? No. Revivals never last. But it sure made a difference for a generation. It made a difference for those people. But notice where it started. It started on the streets. It started with the common people, and only gradually did it reach the king. Then he got in on it. We always think, you know, if we had a Christian in the White House, everything will be fine. Just have a Christian president, have Christian governors, Christian congressmen, and if we just have Christians, everything will be fine. And that's fine, but I don't know that that's required. You don't have to have Christians in leadership to have revival. It can start on the street. It can start with you and me and then reach the king and those in authority over us. Is it hard to swallow? I'm wondering, is it hard to swallow that God still judges sin? He does. But I'm going to tell you something Jonah wouldn't tell those folks. If you will turn to God and repent, judgment can be averted and new life can be yours. Let's pray. We're going to sing in a moment. I'm going to be at the front of the room. And if today you would give your life to Christ, you're tired of life as it has been, and you want a new life, I want you just to get up and come to me, and let me pray with you about that. If you've made this commitment privately but never publicly, you ought to come and let us rejoice that you're a Christ follower too. And if you haven't been baptized, we would love to do that. You saw three children this morning, but most of the time we baptize adults here. It's big strapping Marines and others in that baptistry up there who are saying, I've given my life to Christ. You could be somebody like that. You step out. If you want to join our church, come. Let's at least begin that conversation. We'd love to talk to you about that. Father, bless these who have heard my message today, and I pray you will give courage to respond. Through Christ I pray it. Amen. Let's stand.
Please be seated. Thank you.
Bow with me, please. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your word. We thank you for every way in which you've provided for us. We pray that we would be obedient, empowered by your Holy Spirit, that we would repent where we need to repent, that we would focus on you, and that we would be Christ followers. Please accept now the tithes and offerings that we present. May they be used to glorify you in every way. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.